Can you tell us something about the origin of the technique of Vipassana? When and where did it first appear? And how was it preserved over time?
Anyone who becomes a Buddha becomes Buddha with the practice of Vipassana. After becoming a Buddha, using the practice of Vipassana, he gets fully liberated. And then out of infinite compassion, he starts distributing it to others. For some centuries, people follow it. The technique remains alive. And then slowly it gets lost. The word Vipassana remains with the human society, but the technique gets lost. This enlightened person, Gautama the Buddha, rediscovered this technique. The earlier Buddha also had practiced Vipassana, had taught Vipassana. Therefore, the word Vipassana was available in the society of those days, in the other scriptures of those days, but the practice was totally lost. Gautama the Buddha rediscovered it, distributed it, and then for about 5 centuries, it remained in its pristine purity in India, then it got lost here. It went to different countries. There also slowly it got lost, but one country, Burma, maintained it in its pristine purity from teacher to pupil, from teacher to pupil, and that is why we are getting it now in its pure form.
How did the technique actually go to Burma in the first place, and how was it maintained there? Specify Lady Sayadaw, Sayateji, Bebu Sayadaw, Sayajiv Bakhin.
It's a long history. Even before Buddha, a few centuries before Buddha, people of Sakyan clan had migrated from Kapilvastu to Burma and settled down there. So it is quite possible that these Sakyan people who got settled down in Burma, when they came to know that somebody from their clan has become an enlightened person, naturally they would have got interested in him, and that is how they might have come in contact with the teaching of Buddha. Some of them would have come to India, or people from India might have gone there. But that is something merely of presumption. The history of southern Burma says that a direct disciple of Gautama the Buddha, an arhant by the name of Kavampati, he came from a very wealthy family. His family was involved in big business, international business. His brother had gone and settled down in southern Burma, what is called Thaton today. And he established a city by the name of Suddhamavati and became the ruler of that particular area. When he came to know that his brother has become arhant, naturally he wanted to know what the teaching is which made him arhant. So he requested him to come to Burma. So Gavampati went to Burma, maybe at the time of Buddha, or maybe immediately after Buddha. And when somebody goes there and takes the teaching of Buddha, well, it won't be just the theoretical aspect of Buddha's teaching. Naturally, Buddha is Buddha because of the practice of Vipassana, so he must have taken with him Vipassana. That is how we feel that Vipassana started in Burma. And then there is recorded history that during the time of Ashoka, 2 arhants by the name of Sona and Uttara went to Burma, again taking the teaching of the enlightened one, That means Vipassana. So in southern Burma, there was continuous practice of Vipassana from generation to generation. About 1,000 years back, there was a monk by the name of Arhant, and he was also an Arhant, from southern Burma. He went to middle part of Burma, what is called Pagan now. And so people there are practicing a very corrupt form of Buddha's teaching. So he explained them Buddha's teaching in detail. And then he talked about this technique also. So the king was very much interested in the words of Buddha, the real words of Buddha in Pali language. And then he requested the entire Tripitaka from the king of the southern Burma. And there is a long story. The southern Burma king refused to give, and then he attacked and got those things. But actually this Arhant who was there, he not only taught the theory of Buddha's teaching, he taught practicing of Vipassana also. And the later part of his life, he again migrated to still upper Burma, near Mandle, what is now Sagaing, a hill there. And he stayed there, practicing Vipassana and teaching Vipassana to the people. From then onwards, this Sagaing hill had become a center of Vipassana meditation. From teacher to pupil, from teacher to pupil, people will go to this hill, learn this technique. It was not spread in the masses, but people were there who were practicing in every generation. Historically, the person who comes in limelight is Lady Sayadaw, the very renowned monk, a very learned monk. He thought that without practicing, merely the theory of Buddha's teaching will not help me. So he went to this Sagaing area, contacted the teacher of Vipassana of that time, learned from him, and then he started teaching this technique. Quite a large number of people, monks as well as householders, learned from him. And Sayataji was very much interested in practicing the meditation of samatha, that is concentration of mind, and meditation of vipassana, the purification of mind. He spent about 14 years of his life and learned this technique mainly from Lady Sayadaw, and then started teaching. And from him, quite a few people learned, monks as well as householders, out of whom some started teaching, and Sayaji Ubakhin was one amongst them. This is how we have the recent history of Vipassana.
Vaibhu Sayadaw, would you like to say something?
Vaibhu Sayadaw learned the same technique, but we can't say from where. When Sayaji Ubakhin met him, and he came to know from Sayaji Ubakhin that Ubakhin is practicing this technique of Vipassana, he was amazed, because he had to work for years together in remote places in jungle and all to reach a certain stage. And he found a layman, a householder, having reached quite high in this technique, just remaining a householder. So we can't say either whether Vaibhu Sayadaw developed this within himself, or he went to Sagaing and got it. There is no historical background about it, but certainly he was practicing the same technique.
Can you tell us more about Sayaji Ubakhin?
Sayaji Ubakhin was an important government servant, accountant general of Burma. Then he became director of commercial audit, a very responsible officer who was renowned for his integrity and renowned for his efficiency. these two qualities, he used to say that I got it from Vipassana. And then he started spreading this technique to the other staff of the government. And he helped the administration to come out of inefficiency and non-integrity. And that was a big achievement. He also started teaching Vipassana by establishing the center, International Meditation Center in Rangoon.
How did you first come in contact with Vipassana? And how did it affect your life?
I was a patient of very severe type of migraine, which could not be treated by the best doctors in my country, that is in Burma. I was born there. The attacks were so frequent. Every fortnight I will have a very severe attack. And they were so severe that no painkiller would work. The doctors started giving morphine injection. From the age of 25 to the age of about 30, I kept on taking morphine injection, and the doctors were worried that I might become morphine addict. So they advised me to get myself treated outside in foreign countries, at least to come out of this morphine. I tried with the best doctors in Switzerland, in Germany, in England, in United States, in Japan, but it was utter failure. Nobody could help me to come out of migraine, nor could they give any other alternative except morphine injection. When I returned, a friend of mine, a very good friend of mine, told me to go to Ubakin and take a 10-day course, because migraine is nothing but a symptom of some other disease inside. This migraine in itself is not a disease. So he said, certainly, you have a lot of mental tension. And it was true. My life was full of tension, being involved in business so deeply, being involved in so many social organizations, having so much responsibility. The life was full of tension. So he said, perhaps this Vipassana might help you. That is how I came in contact with Sayaji Ubakhin and Vipassana, and it certainly helped me.
It did help you?
Certainly.
How did actually Vipassana affect your family life?
Well, at a very young age, I was so successful in my business life, in my social life, that the ego became so very much inflated, and I became such a short-tempered person, a very angry person. Everything must happen according to my wishes. Nobody should say or do anything against my wishes. And that made not only me miserable, but all the members of the family were very miserable, very unhappy. All my staff in the office was very unhappy. My workers in my factory very unhappy. And I also felt very bad when I shouted on somebody out of anger. Later on I repented. I should not have done that. Well, I harmed so many persons. This is not the way of life. But I couldn't come out of it. On the other hand, I had been reading scriptures of my tradition, Gita, Upanishad. They are all full of the same teaching. You must learn equanimity. You must come out of craving. You must come out of aversion. Intellectually, I was understanding it. But how to come out of it? There was no way. Merely just contemplating will not help. There must be a way out of it. And fortunately, this became a blessing in disguise, the migraine disease, which brought me to Vipassana. And I found this is applied Gita. This is what people have been teaching from ages, but nobody teaches how to practice it. And here is the practice. I was fascinated by the technique, because this was the applied part of Dhamma, which we have been learning from the very young age. And then when I found really it is giving results, such an angry person, my anger started diminishing. Such an ego-centered person, my ego started deflating. And on the other hand, I started generating love and compassion for others. I found the life so peaceful. My family members, they found a person who was feared by everybody, like a like a devil who has come in the house. Whenever I come, everybody starts trembling. Now there is something, he's going to shout on some reason or the other. If somebody makes a mistake, I'll shout. There's an example in our literature that a ink pot is lying on the floor and by mistake I kick it. And then I shout on others, is this the place to keep ink pot? You mad fellows! I have to shout. Next day the ink pot is there. Somebody else has kicked them. And again I shout, mad fellow, you don't see there is an ink pot there. I will shout in every situation. So this was the kind of habit which I was carrying. And coming out of that, it was such a changed life. My friend started finding that a changed person, how, why, what he has done. And when they came to know this technique, it has helped, given result. They started coming to the technique, and then I found it is not somebody's blessing that I got changed myself. It's the technique which has changed. It started changing others also. There were people who were very mad, not in anger, maybe in fear, maybe in passion, maybe in other things. So many impurities are there, and they started coming out of their impurities. Their life started changing. Oh, then it became so clear that this is a result-oriented scientific technique which has nothing to do with any kind of blind belief or dogma or anything, because it gives a result here and now. And this helped me, and this helped my family members, every member of my family. From the age of 5 years to the age of 80 years, everybody started practicing Vipassana, and the household was so peaceful. We didn't see, while we were in Burma, any quarrel. A big household, about 20, 30 members, but there was never anybody even speaking with a loud voice. The whole atmosphere was so congenial just because of Vipassana. And people started giving example, well, look, these people in Vipassana, they are living such a peaceful life, and yet doing all the responsibility of a householder's life, not running away from them. So it attracted me, it attracted my family, it attracted the society, and people there started taking courses.
What were the circumstances that brought you to India, and how did you start teaching Vipassana? What year was this?
It was in 1969, and by that time I had been practicing Vipassana for 14 years. My parents came to India about a few years back, and my mother developed a kind of mental disease, full of tension, worries, because her children in Burma, she was always worried about us. The government policy had changed, the government had changed, and although we were not in any trouble, but many of the capitalists there were in big trouble. So she had a natural worry that what may happen to my children there, my sons and others. So it was very much, she was out of this worry. She developed this mental tension. And doctors here, the best psychiatrists, they couldn't help her. I knew that Vipassana will help. So I requested the Burmese government, with whom I had very good relations, in spite of the fact that all my industry and business had been taken over by them. And very kindly they issued me a passport, which in those days, it was not easy for a Burmese national to get a passport to go out. And thus I came to India to give a course to my mother specially, and also my father and other relatives here in India.
What happened after the first course?
Well, first course was very successful. Mother came out of her mental problem. Father was also very happy. Although both of them had taken a course in Burma with Sayaji, but they had lost the practice. Another 12 people who participated in the course, they were so benefited that the quality of Dhamma, ehi pasiko, come and see, they started talking to their own relatives, their friends, you come and see this technique, it is so good, it helped me, it will help you also. So the pressure was to have another course. So another course was there. And then another course. Like this, the Ganges of Dhamma started flowing in this country.
Can you tell us something about the establishment of Dhammagiri?
Those who had taken courses with me were eager to have a center established somewhere in India. And because most of the students were from Bombay, they wanted a center to be established around Bombay, somewhere near Bombay. One of them had visited Burma and had met Sayaji Ubakhin while he was alive. And Sayaji Ubakhin told him that, well, look, it is your responsibility to see that a center is established where Goenka can give courses, more serious courses, having better effect, better results. So this person, plus a few more students, they started looking for places where a center can be established. But any suitable place around Bombay was not available. A course was given in Nasik, and one of the wealthy students who was there, when he came to know that a center is necessary and we are looking for a center, he went with me and showed me some places in Nasik, but that was not very suitable. So as we were returning to Bombay in his car, a student of ours from Igatpuri stopped the car, and we went to his house, took tea, and when he came to know that we are looking for a center, he said, well, there is a good place here also, and we came here, and it looked so wonderful, so good. This person, when he came to know who is the owner of this land, and he came to know where his address is, this person was in Bombay. So when he took me to Bombay, I went to the house, my house, but he didn't go to his own house. He went to the owner of this land and asked him what's the price. And this person said, a big amount, 85,000 rupees, which was so much because actual price of the land in those days here was just 1,000 per acre. And it was 17,000. He said 85,000. He took out his checkbook and gave 75,000. And 85,000 got receipt from him. And that's how this land came for Dhamma purpose. And later on more land was purchased round about.
Can you tell us what is taught in a 10-day course? And specify why 10 days are necessary.
Well, the teaching is Sila, Samadhi, Panya, to live a life of morality, to concentrate the mind with the object of respiration, and then to practice Vipassana, to develop your own wisdom, your own Panya, and come out of the impurities of the mind, to purify the mind. About, say, 100 years back, or even 70 years back, the tradition was that a Vipassana course should be for 7 weeks, then only people can understand and can experience the depth of this technique. But then, as the modern age started, the fast life started, such people like me, a business person, can never go for a course for 7 weeks. They started reducing the time. From 7 weeks, they made it 1 month. And then they reduced it to 20 days, to 15 days. And when they came to 10 days, they found people get just an outline of this technique, not that depth which they used to get by 7 weeks course. But less than that, when they started making it for 7 days and all, they found it's a waste of time. So a decision was made that a course should not be less than 10 days. And this 10-day course is started because of that.
Why is it so important that courses are financed only by donations from students who have then taken a course?
Well, this is a very healthy tradition from the past, and it is to keep the technique pure. By taking donation from our students, we are obliging them. We are obliging them that, look, they are accepting your donation and helping you to earn merits, to develop merits. But as soon as a non-meditator starts giving donation and we accept it, then he obliges us. Well, look, I am giving you this money. So things must be done in this way or that way. He will start bossing. Quite possible someday he will say, take these two people in the course. And look, they can't agree to all your discipline and all that. Keep them away from discipline. He may send somebody who might be drinking here. He may send somebody who might not practice but do something else here. This is dangerous. When a student gives, he gives out of a volition that Dhamma should spread. And with that volition, he can't come and boss. He will be very happy to come and serve only. So the tradition is maintained in its pristine purity just because the donation is received as a symptom, a symbol of gratitude from the student to the tradition of Dhamma.
Why don't you promote Vipassana through advertisement so that masses of people will come to know about it? Why is the emphasis on not on word of mouth? On word of mouth.
Well, word of mouth is the word of real experience. Somebody experiences and tells others, well, I have experienced it, it's so good. But when we start advertising by these medias, then it becomes more a commercial publicity. And it won't have that effect. And moreover, we have our own limitation. These courses are residential courses. And there must be facility for people to stay and practice. From the time we started working, we have found, say, this center, Dhammagiri, whatever facility we had is always full. And as the facility grows, more people come. If more people come and there is no facility, what is the use of this calling people by publicity? So as much people as they come by words of mouth, the facility is available and that much is good enough. And like the slow widening of the circle is again the purity of it.
Why Vipassana is taught in prisons and how did it all start?
Well, people in prison are miserable, but this does not mean that those who are outside prison are not miserable. People outside also are prisoners of their own behavior pattern, and Vipassana helps people to come out of prison, to come out of bondage. So far as giving courses in the prisons is concerned, you might have heard about a saintly person of this country who has passed away, Vinoba Bhave. When I met him coming from in Burma after 2 or 3 years, and we were discussing about Vipassana, he said, I will accept the efficacy of the technique only if it is proved in the jail working with the very hard criminals, or it is proved with students in the schools. I said, I am here to serve. If you can arrange, I will teach the hard criminals in the jail. I will teach the students. He arranged in the school, and it was very successful. But he could not arrange in the prison, because the rules of prison, manual of prison is such that a teacher cannot go and stay there. One has to stay outside, and that was not acceptable to me. When a course is given, I must be there with my students. It could not materialize. But later on, the Rajasthan government was good enough to relax their rules, and the first course was given there in the Jaipur jail. And like this, the ball started rolling. And then, since then, many courses in many prisons have been given.
Why is it important to teach meditation to children?
Well, it is a way of life, a good way of life, and at this age one should learn so that they can live a very peaceful life, very happy life, very harmonious life. This is the age when they are learning so many things, and this art of living should also be learned at that age.
You keep mentioning that the technique is scientific. Most people would regard meditation as religious or spiritual. Would you comment on this?
Well, because most of the meditation techniques can be called religious, spiritual, because sectarianism is involved in that. But so far as Vipassana is concerned, there is no sectarianism involved. You can't call it a religion. There is no dogma. There is no blind faith. It is really pure science, a science of the interaction of mind and matter. One has to experience the truth about oneself at the level of mind and matter, how this interaction is going on, how the mind keeps on influencing the matter, how the matter keeps on influencing the mind, and how currents, cross currents, undercurrents are going inside. Because of the ignorance of all that, one keeps on generating negativities, and because of these negativities, one becomes miserable. And these negativities keeps on multiplying. By this technique, one stops the multiplication of these negativities and starts eradicating the negativities. The entire behavior pattern starts getting changed. So this is pure science of mind and matter. We can't call it religion. It's nothing to do with any sect, because everyone from any religion, from any tradition, can practice it and will get the same result.
What is the meaning of the word Dhamma?
Well, Dhamma means nature, characteristic, the truth about nature. Dhamma means law. So we can say Dhamma means the truth about the law of nature, the universal law of nature.
There are people who have the impression that meditation is an escape from reality. But you call it an art of living. Can you elaborate on this?
Maybe certain techniques or certain other way of meditation might be called an escape. But so far as Vipassana is concerned, it is certainly not an escape. It is to live a life. One has got so much responsibility as a householder. One should be able to perform all those responsibilities in a proper way. You are not running away from your responsibility. But you have to learn how to fulfill your responsibilities. It is not an escape, it is not running away. You take your meals twice or thrice in a day, and at that time your other activities are stopped. It's not an escape. You're not running away from your activities. You have to make your body healthy to work. You take physical exercises. You walk. You run to keep your body healthy. And at that time, you can't do any other work. This is not an escape. You are making yourself physically strong so that you can work properly. Similarly, this is a mental exercise. You come to a course to learn this technique, and then daily you practice morning and evening so that you can apply it in your life. You practice 1 hour in the evening, 1 hour in the morning, just to make the mind healthy, wholesome, strong, pure, so that you can work properly. It's a way of life. No escape is involved in it.
If the purpose of meditation is to become detached from worldly affairs, then what relevance does it have to the modern values of efficiency, materialism, and achievement?
Well, a good question. Understand, the attachment is actually not an attachment towards the worldly things. When you go deep inside, you will find that the real attachment is attachments towards your own ego, I. Everything else is to fulfill the desire of this I, to satisfy this I. Vipassana takes you out of this attachment towards your own I, ego, a false, imaginary I, and tremendous amount of attachment towards it keeps one so very much unbalanced in life. So when you come out of this attachment, this does not mean that you will run away from your responsibilities of day-to-day life. Actually, your capacity to work will increase. Attitude will change. Previously, whatever you were working, the whole idea of working hard was to gain something for the satisfaction of your ego. Your ego was important. Satisfaction of your ego was important. Now what important will be that you are working not only for your own good, but for the good of others also. Look, whatever I am doing, it is also helpful to others. So your capacity to work will increase, the attitude to life will change, and you will find it is so healthy. It will be so wholesome. You can live a very peaceful, harmonious life within, and you will generate nothing but peace and harmony for others.
You give so much importance to morality as the foundation of this technique. But isn't morality another form of dogmatism?
In Dhamma, there cannot be any dogmatism. If we had been teaching Dhamma by giving sermons, oh, people of the world, you should not kill, you should not steal, you should not do this, perhaps it would have been just a dogmatism. You believe because your teacher says so. You believe because your scripture says so. Your tradition says so. But here it is not so. When you practice vipassana, you understand that whenever you perform any unwholesome action, say you kill somebody, you can't kill somebody without generating tremendous amount of anger or hatred in you. You steal something, you can't steal something without generating tremendous amount of craving or greed. Similarly, any physical or vocal action which is unwholesome, which goes against morality, which is immoral, starts with a impure mind, a negative mind. And every time one generates negativity in the mind, impurity in the mind, one becomes miserable. That one starts realizing. So again, this is a law of nature, that when I harm others, I can't harm anybody without first harming myself. This is pure science, law of nature. No dogmatism is involved.
What is your message to the world?
The message to the world is to come out of dogmatism. Learn Dhamma as a way of life. Everyone in the world wants to come out of misery. Nobody wants to live a life of misery. Everyone wants to come out of unhappiness, wants to live a peaceful, happy life. But how to live? These sensual places here, there, can make one happy for some time. But then again, the misery starts. As soon as you miss it, the misery starts. Well, there is a way, and a very scientific way, that in every situation, you can live so peacefully and so harmoniously within, and then you can generate peace and harmony to fulfill the entire atmosphere around you, so that people who come in contact with you, they also start living a life of peace and harmony. Nothing like that. So this is for the good of one, this is good for everybody. Everyone in the world wants peace and harmony, and mere sermons won't help. There must be a technique for that. Here is a technique which was lost to the world, to the human beings, last 20 centuries. Now that it has come up, make use of it and enjoy peace, enjoy harmony.